So to begin today's interactive lecture, I wanted to ask you simply to take some notes about a project, about something that you see. What is that you see? I'm going to show you images from a Spanish artist who works in upstate New York, who lives currently in Syracuse, New York, and is a lecturer of fine arts there, and also a photographer and plastic artist. Her name is Ida Lombardia, and Ida is her most recent project that she presented in 2020 is Neo Gods and Hyper Myths through Alarcón Criado Gallery in Spain. Neo Gods and Hyper Myths is a really interesting project that is a reflection on digital media and uses of digital media today, as well as media images that draw from a classical archive of an art historian 100 years ago named Abby Warburg. So this is a research project that draws from an archive of images from the Abby Warburg archive, and nevertheless refigures them into a contemporary context. In other words, we see all kinds of images that are classical in nature, but also from the past 100 years. We're going to see, in other words, selections of images that are both interactive digital media, like the iPhone here, or also images of Venus or Eros and Nike, goddess of victory, in different configurations, reconfigured with, in this case, a tablet. Right. Modernizing the figure of winged Nike, or say Victoria also being the Roman version of Nike. This is Victoria's Secret models. In of course, in 2019, Victoria's Secret announced that it would no longer host its annual runway show for Victoria's Secret models, which is also a major media event, or has been in recent years. And the president of the company claimed that simply times had changed. We see, in other words, that the runway model has been cut out. Her figure with the wings has been replaced with one of the ruins of a statue from Greek antiquity of Nike. We continue down and see similar images of the same, right, same context and same approach, winged in Victoria's Secret models, as we see here. I wanted to ask you, also see the Temple of Nike with Nike shoes. I wanted to ask you what it is you see in this image. Spin down. Dun, 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 dun. Here we are. We have here a towering series of images from a base to the top, which are all spliced together in a linear fashion. And if we take a look then, we can see in the detail some of these. I'm going to give you a few moments. Go ahead and pause the video and take notes. What is it that you see? What is the relationship between these images? What meaning are we to make of them? Continuing on then, we see the full images here. Oops, it's not what I wanted to show yet. This is it. Here it is. There we are. What do you see here? What sense do you make of this image? Go ahead and pause and take some notes. What do you see? Observe first what it is that you see and then explain what meaning it might have. Okay, now once you have your notes, I'll simply call your attention to the rest of the project. We see that Impudens Venus, which is the probably one of the more known statues from Roman antiquity, where we see the nude model covering herself, or at least the limbs, which haven't survived because they've fallen off or deteriorated over time. But we see that the body is posed in such a way that it shows that the female nude was covering herself, almost in a question of being looked at or shame, something we're going to discuss in a moment. And here, in other words, those limbs have been replaced with an empowering gesture of a fist in the air. Here's another that's actually taken from what we just saw. Okay, what I'd like to do then is begin by explaining simply that the media images we see today are often very much taken from or inspired by Western art history, or a tradition of Western art history that could date from more recently the past few centuries, or even Greek and Roman antiquity, two millennia ago or longer. In other words, what we see that there is significant the resonance in the how images are assembled and the cultural codes that inform them that have persisted over time. Of course, here on the left we see a Rubens. And on the right, what we see, of course, is the cover of a Sports Illustrated magazine. In this case, the women are looking back at us as spectators. But the way in which they're arranged or distributed in three is one that resonates with the classical image to the left. There is a difference, though. On the left, it seems as though the spectator has come across these three women, and that we've caught them, so to speak, in an act or seeing them in nude. And the right, it's actually we're interpreted that the male or heterosexual male position is one that is to be interpolated as the viewing subject. In other words, the kinds of gestures that are made are precisely to interpolate us, to make us look back. They're posing. That's something that's quite different from the difference between these two. And nevertheless, the second draws from the first. The more recent Sports Illustrated cover is inspired by or tropes the first. We see this quite a bit, though, in other forms of advertising campaigns, whether it's in, of course, Dolce & Gabbana, a controversial advertisement, which was eventually withdrawn because you have the four male figures of subduing a woman who is looking away. And this being interpreted, of course, as a gesture to violence against women, or if not, a non-sexual encounter. And this was something that was, or a non-consensual sexual encounter or rape. And this is something that was received significant critical attention and finally was pulled from by Dolce & Gabbana. But then clearly we also see others, no? Where we have, for instance, the bodies of the women models turned towards us or turned away in different ways, in ways that resonate with classical painting. I wanted to call your attention to this because often in this class, we're going to be analyzing the contemporary context, but we don't think about the historical antecedents or influences. Okay. So I would like to go back in time then briefly and take a look at the first few moments or minutes of John Berger's Way of Seeing, Ways of Seeing, which is a revolutionary work from the early 70s that's both in print and also in a series of BBC a recorded television program. It revolutionized at the time in the wake of new social movements and second wave feminisms. It revolutionized a critique or an approach to visual studies in Western art history. Let's take a look at the first few moments. I understand that, of course, much of it seems outdated to us, but the actual relevance of what he has to say continues to be relevant.
Men dream of women. Women dream of themselves being dreamt of. Men look at women. Women watch themselves being looked at. Women constantly meet glances which act like mirrors, reminding them of how they look or how they should look. Behind every glance is a judgment. Sometimes the glance they meet is their own, reflected back from a real mirror. A woman is always accompanied, except when quite alone, perhaps even then, by her own image of herself. While she is walking across a room or weeping at the death of her father, she cannot avoid envisaging herself walking or weeping. From earliest childhood, she is taught and persuaded to survey herself continually. She has to survey everything she is and everything she does, because how she appears to others, and particularly how she appears to men, is of crucial importance for what is normally thought of as the success of her life. A woman in the culture of privileged Europeans is first and foremost a sight to be looked at. What kind of sight is revealed in the average European oil painting? There were portraits of women as there were portraits of men, but in one category of painting, women were the principal, ever-recurring subject. That category was the nude. In the nudes of European painting, we can discover some of the criteria and conventions by which women were judged. We can see how women were seen. What then is a nude? In his book on the nude, Kenneth Clark says that being naked is simply being without clothes. The nude, according to him, is a form of art. I would put it differently. To be naked is to be oneself. To be nude is to be seen naked by others and yet not recognized for oneself. A nude has to be seen as an object in order to be a nude. In the European oil painting, nakedness is not taken for granted as in archaic art. Nakedness is a sight for those who are dressed. That is why Manet's painting, which really marks the end of the period I'm considering, is so profound a comment on all the works which preceded it. The story begins with the story of Adam and Eve as told in Genesis. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat. And she gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And the Lord God called unto the man and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. Unto the woman God said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. Two things are striking about this story. They become aware of being naked, because as a result of eating the apple, Each sees the other differently. Nakedness is created in the mind of the beholder. The second striking fact is that the woman is blamed and is punished by being made subservient to the man. In relation to the woman, the man becomes the agent of God. In medieval art, the story is often illustrated scene following scene, as in a strip cartoon. During the Renaissance, the narrative sequence disappears, and the single moment, which is nearly always depicted, is the moment of shame. The couple wear fig leaves or make a modest gesture with their hands. But now, their shame is not so much in relation to one another as to the spectator. It is the spectator's looking which shames them. Later, as painting became more secular, many other subjects offered the opportunity of painting nudes. But always in the European tradition, the nude implies an awareness of being seen by the spectator.
Okay. That's an important point, is that as John Berger is getting at here, the nude, or the notion of nude, or is simply not nakedness. It's the notion that the nakedness is being seen, and also the social construction of shame around that. There's a power dynamic, and it is very gendered. In other words, if we were to update, well, let's begin first with the female nude. In Western art history, as John Berger is telling us, the nude has been constructed for and from the objectifying logic of the male gaze, in particular a heterosexist or heterosexual male perspective. The recurring figure of the reclining female nude in Western art history, called odalisque, from its etymological origin in the Turkish word for concubine, which is odalik, it serves as the modern example of female nudity offered up to male spectators, much in the way that Picasso in his late work obsessed over the scene or encounter between the painter himself and the nude model, sometimes a sex worker, or often a sex worker. Here we see, in other words, that we could update some of John Berger from the 1970s in the context of second wave feminisms and bring him into the present. And that's what I would like to do, and also propose a more contemporary reading then. So more recently, feminist critic Lauren Berlant, who's from Third Wave Feminist, is writing today in Chicago, actually, has revisited Berger's reading of the female nude, and she proposes that the woman who traverses space, as we see in this clip that we've just heard, is not only aware of how she's being watched as both the object of spectators' gazes and as a desiring subject herself, or a desired subject, in a social circumstance. And I quote Berlant, "The centrality of repetition to pleasure and of deferral to desire indeed places the desiring subject in her story," notes Berlant, and also, continue the quote, "makes her a reader of her story," end quote. That's an important aspect that third wave feminisms has brought to second wave feminisms, is not only treating, of course, those instances where there is a clear objectification of woman in representation, but also not depleting her of agency. In other words, it allows the subject to become both an actor and an interpreter of her plot from a number of perspectives at the same time. So troping on what, or updating what, Berger was telling us. Her sense of agency, therefore, is not diminished, and her awareness of her surveillance by others as she traverses the room, even though she is subject to maneuvers made permissible under the watch of others, that negotiate but do not wholly determine her conduct. So what comes to mind for me, in other words, are Rihanna's music video and the lyrics to them, which I'd like to end then by promoting this as a provocative reflection of "This Is What You Came For," where the audience of spectators in the music video that we're about to see is it, it's a recorded club scene. It's entirely a space of social projection. In other words, it's quite literally transpiring in a projected cube of a three-dimensional projection in which our singer is imagining the club scene as she's protagonist of it from different perspectives. This is very much reinforced to us in the, when the artist sings about herself in the third person. That goes between the first person I and the third person as she refers to herself as she, walking across the room toward a love interest, a you, that she addresses in the second person. So we see, in other words, that there's a three subject positions here, or a plurality of positions in Rihanna's music video. She says, "Lightning strikes every time she moves, and everybody's watching her, but she's looking at you." For Berlant, this woman protagonist is also a desiring subject. She has a sense of agency. She's pursuing a love interest on her own, willingly and non-coercively. She is, however, both actor and interpreter at once, even though the limitations of her field of action and choice are already structured into the production of her desire. So I'd like to ask you then, as you have these notes from Lombardia, about specific events that make you think of other interpretations. What cultural codes would you need to be able to interpret the images that we've seen now with the lecture that we've heard? What cultural codes do you need to be able to access an interpretation? Both factual, first-level definition of cultural codes, but also the ideological presumptions that inform those connotations, types, stereotypes, or otherwise, those two levels of cultural codes. And with that question, I'd like to end lecture today by taking a look at this video. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.
Baby, this is what you came for. Lightning strikes every time she moves.